अभी उनका वेट कर लो
सर,
वो बिजी है कहीं ना मीटिंग।
A very good morning to all. Today it is my proud privilege to welcome Honorable Union Minister, Ministry for Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, Dr. Harshvardhan sir, on the occasion of release of India's first ever longitudinal aging study in India, LASI Wave 1 report. Honorable sir has not only gone into detail of the reports, but has also directed that necessary action should also follow besides release. As a result, in the second half, we are having workshop on the major findings of the report and how our national programs on mental health, deafness, oral health, palliative care, blindness and geriatrics care will be able to deal with the issue of healthy aging. I am also to welcome Additional Secretary and Mission Director, Vandana Gurnani Madam, who is giving guidance to this very important national program for health care for elderly. Among the multiple programs under NHM, at a time when preparations are in the full swing in the entire country for the COVID-19 vaccine rollout. I am also to welcome Dr. K.S. James, Director, Indian Institute of Population Sciences, Mumbai, Professor Rajiv Garg, Professor of Excellence from DGHS office, who have provided leadership in conducting this pioneer and very useful study. I am also to welcome all the partners and their representatives such as UNFPA, Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health and University of South in California. Lastly, I want to extend warm welcome to the eminent professors, doctors, officers of the Directorate General of Health Services who are participating in today's workshop. Thank you, sir. Now I request Professor Rajiv Garg, sir, to give an opening address on this occasion.
Honorable Health and Family Welfare Minister Dr. Harshvardhan, ASNMD Madam Shri Mati Vandana Gurnani, Dr. K.S. James, Director IIPS, Joint Secretary Shri Vishal Chauhan ji, all the colleagues from the Directorate and the Ministry, and all participants from the various sites. The National Program for Health Care and for the Elderly, or the NPHCE, has an important objective of ensuring an adequate standard of living for the old, which constitute nearly 12% of the population of India. And it also, at the same time, strives to give a continuous improvement of living conditions and to safeguard their rights to all of the above. It was launched in the year 2010-11, and it is following the various other national policies for the older persons, which were adopted in 1999, the Section 20 of the Health Care of the Elderly Maintenance and Welfare Act. The main aim is to provide a dedicated health facility to the senior citizens above 60 years at various levels, primary, secondary, and tertiary. Almost 713 districts have been roped in for this program, and there are geriatric care OPDs, IPDs, physiotherapy setups, labs under this program. Not only this, there is an apex center of the National Center for Aging at the AIIMS and also one in Chennai, which are coming up. And besides this, we have the regional geriatric centers in almost 19 medical colleges in 18 states. And also it's proposed to integrate the other health programs like the NPCDCS, the NMHP, the National Program for Control of Blindness and Visual Impairment, the National Tobacco Control Program. And the program also has been devising various training modules, and the training of trainers has been done at the state level. Master trainers have been created, so that the district below district level trainings are now being held. And besides these, the IEC activities and capacity building workshops are also going on. So today we have collected here to get the report of the longitudinal aging study in India, the LASI Wave 1, which was launched in 2016. And it's the India's first and the world's largest study, which is harmonized with the Health and Retirement Study, HRS, and its sister studies around the world. This will give a longitudinal database for designing policies and programs for the older populations in the broad domain of social, health, and economic well-being. This study has studied the various characteristics like household characteristics, demographic data, economic well-being, including the mean per capita expenditure, per capita health spending, self-reported chronic health characteristics, functional health, including the limitations of activities of daily living, direct health examination, health risk behaviors, healthcare utilization, and the family and social network. In short, it is a very comprehensive, all-inclusive study of the older population. It has been carried out not only in the states, almost in all the states and the union territories except Sikkim. So the total number is about 72,500, with their spouses also included. So I really look forward to looking at this report after the release by the Honorable Minister Sir, and we'll ensure from our side that these reports are taken into the policy building framework. And subsequently in the afternoon, we are having certain experts in the domain, various parts, and we'll be discussing it in great detail. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. K.S. James, Director, IIPS, Indian Institute of Population Sciences, to give his comments on the LASI Wave 1 findings.
Thank you, and Honorable Union Minister for Health and Family Welfare, T. Harshvardhan Ji, Srimati Vandana Gurnani, Mission Secretary and Mission Director, MIHFW, Sri Vishal Chauhan Ji, the Joint Secretary at the MIHFW NCD Division, and Dr. Rajiv Garg, Professor of Excellence at the DGHS, Dr. Gauri Sengupta, DG NPHC, distinguished participants. It's a proud moment for all of us that the Honorable Minister is releasing the report of the first wave of the longitudinal aging study in India, LASI. And not to realize the vision of making progress towards healthy aging, we need a far better understanding of the age-related health issues and trends. And LASI, as all of you know, collects very high quality, scientifically sound, and internationally comparable data on the status, the capabilities, and the need for India's older adults, their households, and their communities. I'm confident that the information from LASI will play a very critical role in our vision to ensuring a universal health coverage in this, particularly in this decade of healthy aging. Sir, nearly 6 years ago, in 2014, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, along with IIPS, launched the LASI as part of the National Program for the Healthcare of the Elderly. There are other collaborating institutions, Harvard University, USA, University of Southern California, and also we have received funding from the UNFPA, India, and National Institute of Aging, USA. I would like to place also on record our sincere thanks to all the collaborating institutions and supporting institutions. The first wave collected data from around 72,250 individuals of age 45 years and older, of which about 31,464 are age 60 and above, which enables to provide estimates at the state level and for cross-state analysis. All the health and retirement surveys the world has pointed out, the LASI is the largest in terms of its sample size. The survey used several instruments, the household questionnaire at the household level, a detailed older adults questionnaire, which is an individual questionnaire. Then there was also community details which has been collected, and there are also biomarker information which has been collected as part of the survey. Sir, perhaps the single most or biggest advantage of LASI, we will say, it is its longitudinal nature, visiting the same household every 2 years. It is now widely accepted world over that immense value of longitudinal studies for framing, developing, and evaluating policy, particularly in terms of tracking the effects of social, lifestyle, and technological changes over time. It is similar to the advantage of an individual gets once he or she visits repeatedly the same doctor for the health issues. At population level for policy formulation, it is important to understand and how and why chronic diseases develop, what lifestyle change modification can really address such issues, which intervention can matter more, etc. Thus, LASI, once repeated data are available every 2 years, can significantly transform our public health policies, their interventions, and also building a credible curative healthcare systems in the country. LASI provides a host of information at the health status of the older population, which includes functional health measurement like vision, lung function, blood pressure, etc., and anthropometric measures like height, weight, and performance-based tests like grip strength, time to walk, balance test, and DBS collection. And in addition, it also gives a variety of information on health status, healthcare utilization, cost of healthcare utilization, financing of health, perceived health status, disease pattern, and host of other issues. As I told you, the study is very large and wide, so I would not be able to summarize really the findings of the study in a very few sentences. But I thought perhaps three important points really emerge from LASI is really critical for this country. The first, as all of you know, the LASI provides information on the prevalence of most chronic diseases across socioeconomic gradients. I think that is one of the important message which LASI gives. For instance, the current data shows that almost 55% of the elderly in the country has some chronic diseases, which perhaps is something around, you can say, 75 million people in this country. And almost 27% of them has a multimorbidity, which is constituting something around 35 million elderly in this country. And it also conveys something around 45 million are affected by cardiovascular diseases and hypertension, and also around 20 million diabetes cases. Thus, LASI is providing government with the critical information to pinpoint and assist locations with the levels and unmet need for geriatric care and speciality in services. I think that is perhaps the first important message the LASI will be giving the public at the public domain. And secondly, LASI also provides information on the enormous opportunities available because of the aging in this country. Because, for instance, the LASI data shows almost 24% of the elderly, that around 33 million in this country, has difficulty with at least one activities of daily living, like walking or eating or toileting, etc. It means that even if you consider that 90% of them are taken care of at the family level, even if we need 10% of them needs the care with a care assistant, it means that around 4 million care workers need to be generated in this country. It provides enormous opportunity in terms of employment. It also challenges all of us actually in providing training to these care workers. So that way, we can say there's enormous opportunities that really LASI shows us how to actually move forward in the future. And lastly, or finally, you know, the aging is not a matter of the health alone, but it is overall well-being of the elderly which we look forward. LASI provides information on what helps in enhancing the well-being of the elderly, whether it is social support system, whether it is economic measures, whether it is community support and participation, and a variety of other indicators which shows us how actually well-being of the elderly can be enhanced. For instance, LASI data shows that the health and social welfare programs that India has targeted towards elderly are working, and how actually it has really helped in the utilization of the programs, as well as how it is reaching out to millions of elderly in this country. Actually, to sum up, it's certain that government-sponsored effort to generate, analyze, and act upon the large body of scientific and rich data will continue to yield big dividends for improving our understanding of the health, social, and economic conditions of the older Indian adults. Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, especially the Honorable Minister and the senior officers like Secretary, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, SNMD, has taken keen interest in the findings of the LASI when we had a detailed presentation earlier with all the findings of the LASI. Undoubtedly, LASI will provide a way for better decision-making about the programs and policies aimed at supporting one's India's biggest or greatest asset, we can say, the India's older population. I once again express my sincere thanks to National Program for the Healthcare of the Elderly, the MOHFW, for taking the lead in the LASI study. And thank you for all your support and guidance. Thank you once again.
Thank you very much, Professor James. Now I request Madam Vadula Gurnani to address on the issue. Thank you.
Honorable Union Minister for Health and Family Welfare, Dr. Harshvardhan ji, Dr. Rajiv Garg, Professor of Excellence, my colleagues in the Ministry, Vishal Chauhan, Dr. Gauri, and other officers, Director IIPS, Dr. James, and all the experts and representatives from the academic institutions who have contributed in a very valuable manner to the design and the conduct of LASI. Sir, as we all know that population aging is something which is almost like an unprecedented global demographic transformation which our country is experiencing. So in terms of sheer numbers, as we can see, India is poised at a demographic transition from approximately 9% population over 60 years in 2011 to 20% in 2050. And if in this we include the pre-retirement phase, the older adult population, which is age 45 and above, this will rise to constitute over 40% of the population of India, or 655 million people by 2050. The proportion of people aged 75 and above is expected to increase by 340% between 2011 and 2050. The demographic vis-a-vis the epidemiological transition in India has therefore shifted a major share of country's burden of diseases to this elderly population. Sir, though this process of aging has been constantly investigated by several experts, there was no comprehensive and internationally comparable national survey data in India that was available hitherto, which covered the entire range of topics that have been covered in LASI, that include health, economic, social and psychological aspects of the aging process. So coming to the programs, the Ministry, sir, has been committed to the entire cause of healthy aging. And this commitment began with the launch of the National Program for Healthcare for Elderly, which was done in 2011. And as part of this program, sir, several initiatives have been undertaken under the National Health Mission. So we have a minimum of 10-bedded geriatric wards, which are supported under this program at all the district hospitals. We have rehabilitation services at the CHC level, right down up to the CHC level, which have also been supported under the National Health Mission. Now, sir, I would like to submit for your kind information, sir. As you remember, in one of the discussions during the UHC day, sir, Secretary Health had said that under your leadership, a silent revolution in terms of the health and wellness centers is occurring in the country. And so through the health and wellness centers, one of the comprehensive package of services, the 12 services that is intended to be given, is the care for the elderly, or the geriatric care, sir. So, sir, I'd like to submit that the guidelines for the healthcare for the elderly have been drafted and they would be shortly finalized by the technical divisions in the ministry. But broadly, sir, I would like to mention that these guidelines provide a complete service delivery framework at the last mile. That is, what would be done at the community level by the ASHAs, by the CHOs, what would be done at the health and wellness center level, what would be done at the PHC level, and what would be done at the secondary and tertiary level, including by the specialists. Overall, sir, this framework covers, number one, promoting active and healthy aging. Secondly, identification of intercurrent illnesses like cardiovascular diseases, which Dr. James was referring to. Then cerebrovascular diseases, respiratory diseases, mental illness, cancer, etc. Early identification of disabilities, including cognitive decline, limited mobility, malnutrition, visual impairment, and hearing loss. Primary care management, as I mentioned, sir, at all levels, and assuring the continuum of care with proper bidirectional referral. So the unique proposition of this care at health and wellness center level would be, sir, community-based mobilization and support. As you are aware, sir, as our Indian culture still takes care of the elderly at home and in community settings, this would be the primary focus of this entire strategy, wherein our ASHAs and multipurpose workers and the CHOs will be working with the communities through the VHSMCs and through the Jan Arogya Samitis to ensure that there is an enabling environment for taking care of the elderly within the community settings. The proper screening would be done at the health and wellness centers, followed by the referrals at the PHC and the higher levels. There would also be provision for developing a personalized care plan for the elderly and ensuring the reach of medicine, especially to the elderly who are homebound for on account of certain health reasons. It would also provide for imparting training and skills to the caregivers so that they can take care of the elderly. And thereafter, management at the appropriate levels, whether it's at the PHC level or at the secondary level and the tertiary level through various interventions of the government, including the PMJ. So that entire continuum of care approach, sir, is being worked out and would be shortly finalized by the ministry. Coming to the survey, sir, it has given us major policy and programmatic pointers, which will help not only us at the national level, sir, but also at the state level through the state fact sheets, wherein they would be able to observe those and see what are the specific state-specific interventions that states also need to undertake when it comes to the care of the elderly. So we would also be using these findings for interdepartmental, intersectoral collaboration, as a lot of work needs to be done by other departments, by other ministries, by the NGOs, by the other academic institutions, multinational agencies, etc., as we move forward to develop the implementation framework. So as per your guidance, as Vishal had presented, today itself we are having a workshop with the key programs in the ministry so that we can have a common plan for the elderly as under your guidance, sir. This would also be followed by dissemination workshops and webinars, several more after the one which is going to be conducted today. So I just like to conclude by saying, sir, that we under your leadership, sir, especially under the National Health Mission, we are completely committed to the care of our seniors, who in our culture, sir, we have utmost respect for. And we will be using the findings of this last study, especially for the community-based interventions at the Health and Wellness Center for the elderly under your guidance, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Now I request Honorable Minister, sir, to release LASI Wave 1 report, executive summary, India fact sheet, 35 states, union territory fact sheets, and infographics, health domain, and social economy.
I know that. It's difficult to hold on to. These are the 35 states fact sheets.
Thank you. state factory.
I thank you very much, sir. Now I request Honorable Minister, sir, to give his keynote address.
Yeah, thank you.
Madam Vandana Gonani ji, Additional Secretary and MD, National Health Mission, Shri Vishal Chauhan, Joint Secretary, Ministry, Professor Rajiv Garg, Professor of Excellence, and also the former Director General Health Services, Dr. Gauri and Sen Gupta, ADG of the National Program for Healthcare of Elderly, NB Money, DSNCD, and we also have the distinguished presence of two virtual mode, Dr. Roderico Offrin, the WHO representative of India, Ms. Nadia Rashid, Deputy Resident Representative UNDP India, Dr. K.S. James, the Director of International Institute of Population Sciences. And I understand that there are many other very significant and very important people who are attending this function and who shall be part of the symposium or maybe the meeting that will follow this brief inaugural ceremony, where I have been very privileged to be part of it and have also been privileged to release the first longitudinal aging study in India, popularly known as LASI Now Wave 1, India's report, and also the executive summary and also the fact sheet, and then another good thing about the report, that there are fact sheets about each state. So I think this is a very, very comprehensive thing that has been done, and we really feel proud about it, because it is probably the first and the largest ever survey report probably of this nature being done, not only in India. Maybe it's something which we can say that it's probably the largest in the whole world also. I don't have the data about the whole world, but I feel that it is certainly something very, very important. We all know that in the 2011 census report, we had a population of for 60 years age and above people. This was about 8.6%, accounting for almost 103 million elderly. And as per the projections that have been given, by 2050, we are supposed to be having this increased to 319 million. And if we study and try to project how many people are we going to have above 45 in 2050, so this number goes up to 650 million. So data themselves speak for what we should be doing, and how much sincere, committed, meticulous, and visionary we should be about the scheme of things that we are planning, about our vision and about the implementation mechanisms. So I think this report, and I must thank Dr. P.S. James and all his team members, because I understand that the report has people from NPHCE, IIPS Mumbai, Directorate DHS. THS and this Harvard T.A. Chan School of Public Health, University of Southern California, National Institute of Aging, and also the United Nations Population Fund India. So it's not a routine report that has been projected or published or maybe brought into public domain today. And when I had gone into the details of how this report, which we say that is probably one of the best or maybe one of the largest report based on one of the largest survey, technology and the techniques that have been used, they can easily be described and defined as state of the art, with you can say there are representative samples of India and all the states, as this fact sheet about the various states also depicts quite well. And this is all by socioeconomic spectrum. Then the expensive topical focus on it, the harmonization with HRS, the longitudinal design, the coverage of comprehensive. I think there's a very important thing that is unique about the report, that there's a coverage of comprehensive biomarkers and use of computer-assisted personal interviewing. So it's not a routine report. The people are going and somebody is filling some form and then you come out with a report. Parameters around quality control have also been very strictly monitored and maintained. And then there is a contribution about the geographic information systems, which we popularly call as the GIS system. So there are so many good things about the report, which have gone into the foundation of actually creating it, involvement of the top institutions and the people within the country and outside the country and from places even like Harvard and all. So that speaks volumes about the quality of the report. And then the important fact why we should actually have this report, and then ultimately the fact that why it should now be meticulously used to make amends in our programs, to improve them, to strategize and strategize at various levels, and to have maybe a state-specific or district-specific strategies, etc., etc., where, because the report says that 75% of the people, elderly people, they are suffering from one or other chronic disease. And we otherwise, we know that we have elderly people around all of us, and we know that they have their problems, but no one has ever either tried to calculate or assess the extent of it, and no one has ever tried to actually go into the nitty-gritty of what it is about. So when you say that 75% of the people in the elderly age group have one or the other chronic disease, and 40% is such a big number that they have one or the other disabilities. And then another big number, which was like very, it was like troubling my mind and heart, was that 20% of them are suffering from mental health issues. So these basic data, I think they are so important for us that we need to basically get into all those who are now concerned about the report and what we should be doing about the report, because it has the inputs from 72,250 persons above 45 years. It is, except, as was told here in this program, that except Sikkim, probably all the states and the union territories were involved. and 31,464 people are above 60 years and 6,749 people above 75 years. They were all involved in this. And this is the first time that there is a detailed information on health of so many subjects. Plus, there is information about the biomarkers also. That's a very, very important thing. Information on their family and social network, their incomes, their assets, and all these consumption and all the related issues. And there is a, I think this is a very, very important report, because the data that has been produced here, it is going to help us and guide us, and maybe for the researchers to understand the science of aging, because there is so much which is happening. Because as a science and technology minister also, I know so now even things like gene editing and so many things are happening which can delay the progression of the diseases or their appearance in old ages. And we I think should ensure that we provide the best to our elderly people, because they are like God for any family. And they deserve the best possible attention. They deserve our utmost care. They deserve the earliest diagnosis. And once the diagnosis is done, they deserve the best possible treatment, whether it is routine medication or things like that. And that is why, as Vandana ji had also reminded us, that India, which is having one of the most ambitious and probably the most powerful program of the whole world, moving towards universal health coverage, the Ayushman Bharat, and with the component of health and wellness centers there, where we are planning by the end of next year 1.5 lakh health and wellness centers. Almost one third of that has already been achieved. Another one third, we are in the, you can say, process of achieving the next month, 2 months or so, because you see, support systems for those have already been provided to the states. But there also, the focus is on basically prevention and promotive health and positive health, and ensuring that because when Dr. James was giving us some overview, he mentioned about the data around the diabetes and hypertension. Because I don't want to, I had casually seen the report before coming here, so maybe talking in detail about the contents may take a long time. But he also mentioned about diabetes, prevalence of diabetes and hypertension, and he was mentioning something like 45-50% and all. So in the Ayushman Bharat scheme also, there is a very, very specialized focus on screening around diabetes, screening for hypertension, and of course screening for these cancers like cancer of the oral cavity, the breast, the cervix. And now there's a lot of guidelines have been made, especially she mentioned about the guidelines about care of the elderly, which have been very meticulously finalized, and they have now been conveyed to the healthcare workers at the grassroots level, so that at the health and wellness centers also, we have now a very detailed exclusive focus for the care of the elderly. And we all know that they suffer from so many illnesses. And even I remember 25 years back as a health minister, I was Dr. Garg can appreciate that well, quite well. He had been in the medical college, a professor in Delhi, that when we had to launch the cataract free Delhi campaign, it was so shocking that cataract, which is treatable, and which can restore anybody's literally lost vision, people were not even getting this much of basic. As an ENT surgeon, I remember I launched 25 years back the Shravan Shakti Abhiyan, because all the hearing losses that you have because of presbycusis and senile deafness and all these things, and so many other things. There is already mentioned about the mental health, etc., etc. So the senior people, and I always say that this hypertension, and especially the essential hypertension, which is again an aging process. Somebody can have a secondary hypertension because of some ailments in some organs, but the essential hypertension is basically an aging process. And if in a country like India, if we cannot ensure that everybody's hypertension is diagnosed and everybody's hypertension is treated, because the people who suffer from hypertension, and I feel that the programs around hypertension, they need to be strengthened, revisited, and planned at a sort of a movement level, because hypertension, and especially essential hypertension, it actually affects the elderly people. Gradually they have all these ailments involving the heart and other things, and of course there is so much to talk about, because this is one of my very passionate subjects, and I really love this report from the core of my heart, because this is something which is unique, which has happened for the first time. There is a data, and what we may be knowing in general, we know in specifics, and specifics also we know state-wise. So now the interventions and the type of help that we provide to the states in the National Health Mission, we have mechanism to monitor it also, to plan the type of help that we have to supplement year by year, and specific to the program also. So I think all this things that have been put in this report, they need to be very carefully observed by the relevant people, not only here in the department only. Even for those who have produced the report, they should also be helping in it. Their job was not only to get the report produced after getting the surveys done. I would suggest that they should all be now actively, from their heart, mind, and soul, be involved in strengthening of the strategies and the plans and the policies for the care of the elderly in the coming years. You have a new report which gives you something to augment or further strengthen. And lastly, the one fact that gives me a great amount of pleasure and satisfaction is that today's function is not a routine function where some minister comes and releases the report. This function is followed now by very good, detailed, interactive sessions, where I am told that at least representatives or the planners or the executors of literally six national programs involving eye care or the mental care or other things which are particular to the well-being and the health of the elderly, they are all meeting after this. They are all going to discuss this report, and they are all going to have a hands-on, you can say, approach and a discussion with the people who were instrumental in producing this report, so that immediately they can also plan the augmentation of their already ongoing programs. So that's, I think, the better part of this. One was the making of the report, following survey. Another was the release today, but the ultimate part, which is the most important. So we are not waiting and wasting even a minute in initiating on that. So that's, I think that gives me significant amount of satisfaction. So once again, I would like to thank all of you who are here in this room with me, and of course who are there virtual mode. I can see many on the screen. Maybe I don't recognize each one of you on the screen, or may not have acknowledged your presence here in this very important function. And all those who are going to be part of the following session, I congratulate you, express my good wishes to all of you, and I'm hopeful that this new year 2021, apart from the fact that it brings us out of the miseries that were caused by COVID in 2020, it brings a new ray of hope for our elderly people. I think that's our solemn duty towards them, and that is what we should be planning and working for in the new year. So thanks all of you once again. Good wishes.
Thank you very much, sir, for your kind words. Now, finally, I request Dr. Gauri Sengupta to give vote of thanks.
Honorable Union Minister for Health and Family Welfare, Dr. Harshvardhan ji, respected Professor of Excellence, Dr. Rajiv Garg sir, respected AS and MD ma'am, Nandana Gurmani ma'am, IMPS Director, Dr. S.K. James, Joint Secretary sir, Shri Vishal Chauhan ji, and other dignitaries joined in for the welcoming. I consider it a great privilege to propose a vote of thanks to all the dignitaries and colleagues who have made it convenient to attend this function to release the India report of the Longitudinal Aging Study of India, commonly known as LASI, Wave 1, along with India and 35 states' fact sheets, the executive summary, and infographics of health and social domains. The report shall be available on the NPHCE and the IIPS website, sir. The data set of LASI shall rest with IIPS and be accessible to academicians, scientists, for research purposes on request. Today's function has been a fitting tribute of the National Program for Healthcare of Elderly for understanding the process of healthy aging. It is our abiding commitment to the welfare of elderly people in delivering universal health coverage through a life course approach and also developing a society for all ages. We are deeply grateful to the Honorable Union Minister for Health and Family Welfare, Dr. Harshvardhan ji, for presiding over this function as the chief guest. Your presence today at this function has immensely enhanced the importance of this report, sir. Your address was unique, as always, because of the novelty of ideas as well as the vision, sir, and I thank you for presiding over this function and your address. I am also thankful to respected Professor of Excellence, Dr. Rajiv Garg sir, for being with us today and always. You have always been a guiding force in the right direction, sir. I must express my deepest gratitude to our respected Additional Secretary and MD ma'am, Vandana Gurmani, who has relentlessly supported us in this endeavor, right from the initiative of holding this function, sir, to the planning of events that are to follow in the coming months. Thank you, ma'am, for your enlightening supports, insights, and always being there to correct us. I also express my sincere thanks to Joint Secretary, sir, Shri Vishal Chauhanji, who has taken keen interest in this program. Your inputs and belief in this program has pushed us to deliver this function and the subsequent workshop. On behalf of the team of National Program for Healthcare of Elderly, I am grateful to the Director of International Institute of Population Sciences, Dr. K.S. James, the whole team of LASI at IIPS, Harvard T.H. Chan, University of Southern California, National Institute of Aging, United Nations for Population Aging, UNFPA, for conceptualizing, conducting, and supporting to deliver the wave one of LASI. I would be failing if I don't acknowledge all those who have worked relentlessly in the last week for making this function a stupendous success, that is the Central Program Division of NPHCE, with our Deputy Secretary, Under Secretary, and consultants. I also acknowledge the assistance offered by Abhinav Guptaji in helping us to organize this function, his team, and last but not the least, the NIC, which shall be assisting us in the workshop from 2 p.m. also, sir. Last but not the least, I am thankful to all the colleagues, supporters, and well-wishers from the states. We are joined in by the state program officers of all the states of not only National Program for Healthcare of Elderly, but also of National Mental Health Program, Oral Health Program, NPCP, VI, and also others for palliative care and also medical colleges, institutes, regional geriatric centers, WHO International, HelpAge, other NGOs and community-based organizations who have taken out time and joined us through the web link and will be also with us through the workshops. Lastly, I'd like to end with a shloka which says, Acharya Padamadade Padam Shishya Swamedhya Padam Sabrahmacharibhyam Padam Kalena Kamena Cha. It says, a student learns a quarter from the teacher, a quarter from own intelligence, a quarter from fellow students, and the rest in the course of times. We at NPHCE consider ourselves as these students who shall endeavor to learn from all the quarters, sir, in this decade of healthy aging. On behalf of the team of National Program for Healthcare of Elderly, I thank you all once again and request you to join us back in the same link for the first workshop to address comprehensive geriatric assessment and care delivery through various national health programs shortly after this function. Thank you, sir.